Okay, we'll be in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. The title of the message is Carelessly Neglecting or Carefully Inspecting. And listen as I read our text. We must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard so that we do not drift away. For since the message was spoken through angels was binding, and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? The salvation which was first announced by the Lord was confirmed to us by those who heard him. God also testified to it by signs, wonders, and various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. Now, the book of Hebrews is a book of exhortations or encouragements that are designed to make us aware of several different things. And one of those is where we're at today, and that's the danger of drifting. You get over to Hebrews chapter 3, beginning in verse 17, you have the danger of doubting. Then in Hebrews 5, beginning in verse 11, the danger of dejecting. Hebrews 10, 26 through 39, the danger of defying. And then in Hebrews 12, the danger of disobeying. But notice a couple of things about our text this morning. The author called our attention to what we have heard, and he said, we must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard so that we do not drift away. Now, whenever you see the word therefore in a verse, it's there for a reason, okay? And so it's directing our attention back to what was said in chapter 1. And when Paul instructed us to pay the most careful attention to what was said in the first chapter, and especially in those first four verses. And so when it says pay the most careful attention, it's not just a casual glance like you're looking at the front page of a newspaper, and they actually used to have those things delivered to your homes. But it's giving spatial and complete attention and care to something or to someone. So what was said in the first chapter of Hebrews 1? In Hebrews chapter 1, we're told that Jesus is superior to all of the Old Testament prophets and superior to the angels. Furthermore, Christ is the most splendidly glorious and supreme person of the universe. He's the creator, sustainer, heir of all things, and the infinitely superior king, ruler, and redeemer of all creation. And so Paul, who I believe wrote the book, outlines that and sets forth that truth in about the first four verses of this book. And Paul is saying, based on that truth, those truths, we want to make sure that we do not drift away from that truth and get ourselves into trouble. And the Bible does warn us about the danger of drifting. In Deuteronomy verse 4 and verse 9, it says, only give heed to yourself and keep your soul diligently, so that you do not forget the things which your eyes have seen and do not depart from your heart all the days of your life, but make them known to your sons and your grandsons. And so there is a danger of drifting away from the truth. And if you've ever run some rivers, there's a real danger of getting caught in the wrong current in a river too, because it can take you down the wrong path. Harold, I watched a little bit of The River of No Return yesterday. You've probably seen that Western, and I caught a little bit of it, and there was a danger there of the current in that river. But what Paul is saying is that we need to be careful and we need to be disciplined in our lives as Christian. We're to assimilate and appreciate the truth of the gospel, not eviscerate it by equivocating it with the bloodless, milquetoast gospel that's woke theology of today. And you know society is adrift when its focus is more on being politically correct, even if it's morally wrong. Our hearts and minds will either be captivated by the world's false philosophy or regulated by the truth of God's word and his moral principles. Years ago, when the second Bush was president, Attorney General John Ashcroft, he'd been a senator over in Missouri, spoke about this. He said, we have outlawed stigma by saying it's politically incorrect and inappropriate to say certain things are wrong. We're no longer capable of identifying things as wrong, and we're no longer capable of ranking for affirmation things that are legal. Once you devalue affirmation and you outlaw stigma, you make it impossible for culture to shape moral choices. We should take the hostility toward morality out of the system and take the hostility towards faith out of the system. Pastors need to call people to the highest and best, not accommodate the source at its lowest and least. And even though he did not use this language, he was seeing a nation adrift and was giving us a warning. When we drift away from God's word, we are neglecting the moral absolutes of God's Bible. Chuck Colson said one time, "If there are no moral absolutes, there are no value-associated reasons to make one decision over another. We may as readily choose to ignore a neighbor rather than help him, to cheat rather than to be honest, to kill rather than let live. The outcome of our choices carry no moral weight. No longer are we guided by virtue or tradition. Selfish passions breed freely. Gone are notions of duty to our fellow man and to the Creator. As a result, there's no straight edge of truth by which to measure one's life. Truth is pliable and relative. It can take whatever shape we want." And that's where we are in society. We've drifted away from the truths of who God is, of who God's Son Jesus Christ is, and we're wanting to live our own lives as though we're little gods in control of everything. Let me give you some examples of drifting in the Bible. Lot disobeyed and went into rebellion with his brother or his uncle Abraham and drifted into Sodom and sacrificed his values in Genesis 13 and 19. Samson drifted into compromise and fornication when he laid aside his Nazarite vows, and he ended up losing his vision in Judges 13 through 16. David drifted into adultery and then murder and lost his virtue and a son in 2 Samuel 11. What we should not ignore, Paul is saying, is the great salvation. And if we begin to drift away from that truth, he says, how shall we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? The only message we have to share, the only hope that we have in this world in which we live, is Jesus Christ. He's the way, the truth, and the life. See, salvation is great for several reasons. I got about four or five of these. It's great because of its source. In Hebrews 1:3, when Jesus had accomplished cleansing for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. He is the only source of salvation. Romans 4:12 says, "For neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Salvation is great because it meets the universal need of mankind. For all have sinned to come short of the glory of God, is what Paul said in Romans 3:23. And in John 3:36, he said, "The one who believes in the Son has eternal life. The one who rejects the Son will not see life, but God's wrath remains on him." Jonathan Edwards, years ago, preached a sermon called "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." And he just stood there and read it as he normally did in a very bland manner. But the Holy Spirit got a hold of that, and people were actually gripping their pews because they felt like they were about to fall into hell. It was such a powerful sermon. Edwards said, "Every sinner is like a spider dangling by a thread over a fire. Only God's mercy keeps us from falling into the eternal flames." And you see, our only hope is in the remedy that Jesus Christ provides, and that's salvation for sinners like you and me. Now, there's an old song that says, "Come thou fount of every blessing." Let me just give you one of the refrains. "Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above." And we need to be aware of where we are in our Christian experience so we are not drifting away from God's word. You see, most people don't lose their religion in a blowout. It's a slow leak at a time, like a flat tire. And it can creep up on us very quickly before we realize the plight that we're in. Here's another reason salvation is great. Because you read the Bible and you see it was confirmed by eyewitnesses. There were people who were alive at Jesus, walked with Jesus. They saw the sacrifice. They saw the life he lived. And they could confirm what he had said. It was not just some random myth or tale. In John chapter 20, verses 30 through 31, John said, "Now Jesus performed many other miraculous signs," now get this, "in the presence of his disciples." They were eyewitnesses of it. And if they had not, if what was being written by John or Matthew or Mark or Luke had been in error, they would have disputed it, and it would have never sailed. But it was he did the miracles in the eyes of, in the presence of the disciples, which are not even recorded in this book. But these are recorded, why? So that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. It were eyewitnesses' accounts. Then in John 15, verses 26 through 27, when the advocate comes, and he's speaking about the Holy Spirit, whom I will send you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me, and you also will testify, listen, because you have been with me from the beginning. The salvation is great because it's not some fable made by man. But there are eyewitnesses that confirm the life, the miracles of Jesus, his death, and his resurrection. Salvation is also great because of its precious promises. One of the promises is everlasting life in John chapter 5, verse 24. Verily, very truly, I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but is crossed over from death to life. Another great promise of salvation is that we're saved from the wrath of God, Romans 5, 9. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? Another promise is that we're no longer under condemnation. Romans 8, 1. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That's because Jesus paid the penalty, and I'm no longer under condemnation because I believe him as my Lord and Savior. Another promise is that we cannot be separated from God's love, beginning in Romans 8, 31. If God is for us, who can be against us? Now, right there's a sermon in itself, isn't it? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or sword? No. Nothing can separate us from God's love once we are his children. Another promise is he will never abandon us in Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or tremble before the enemy. For the Lord your God is the one who is going with you. He will not fail you or abandon you. And he promised in John 14:26 that he'd never leave us helpless. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I've said to you. One of the great preachers, evangelists of years gone by was Dwight Moody. They've got the Moody Bible Institute up in Chicago. It's a good institution, and the Moody Church has always been pastored by some fine men. Herbert Lockyer wrote a book, and he's got a quote about Moody when he was dying. Lockyer wrote several books, but this one has to do with the last words of dying saints. And here's what he says, and I quote, "A few hours before entering the homeland, Moody caught a glimpse of the glory awaiting him. Awakening from a sleep, he said, earth recedes, heaven opens before me. If this is death, it's sweet. There's no valley here. God is calling and I must go." Moody's son was standing beside his bed and he said, "No, no, Father, you're dreaming." And Moody replied, "No, I am not dreaming. I have been within the gates. I have seen the children's faces. A short time elapsed, and then following what seemed to the family to be the death struggle, Moody spoke again. This is my triumph. This is my coronation day. It is glorious." And I've had the privilege to be at the bedside of many old saints who were dying, and they had similar experiences like to this. I've had some say, do you see him out there, Pastor? And I said, "I don't see him, but I believe you're seeing him. Would you tell me what you're seeing?" "Well, right there on the foot of my bed, do you see those angels sitting right there?" And I said, "No, I don't see him, but I believe you're seeing him." And I said, "Is that comforting you?" "Oh, yes, it's very comforting. They've come to get me and take me on to heaven." And that's our hope in Jesus Christ. And when we do not drift from the truth, and when we remain faithful to God's word, we can have these same experiences and not fear death ourselves. I'm going to leave you with four things to keep in mind. God does not know of a sin that he does not hate. He does not know of a sinner that he does not love. He does not know of a better plan of salvation. And he does not know of a better time for the lost to be saved. Well, Father, as I come now, I want to thank you for this time today. that we can share in your word. And I pray, Father, that we'll be aware of our needs. Father, that we'll persevere, that we will not drift, but that we'll remain steadfast. I pray, God, that you'll work in our lives, that you'll speak to us during this time of invitation. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I'm going to invite you to stand with me as we get ready to sing this song of invitation. I invite you to come today.